Hi, my name is Donna Futterman, and I'm a pediatrician and ran a program for adolescents and young adults with and to prevent HIV for over 30 years. I was very excited to be engaged in this because I think the whole issue of communication between doctors and other healthcare providers and parents about pediatric vaccines is really crucial, and I think we all have a lot to learn, so thank you for participating in this. Before we get started, I'd like to share some definitions of terms that we'll frequently be using. Let's start with health equity. Health equity is the opportunity for all families and people to have equal outcomes in their health. And that means that we have to address the barriers that exist to them not getting equal access. When we talk about vaccine access, we have to look at three components of that. The first is physical access. Are the places where you go to get your vaccine accessible to you? The second is socioeconomic. Can you afford it? And the third, I think, is a mental access, which is, do you believe that you and your family are entitled to the best that healthcare has to offer? And a lot of people feel and experience society as not offering them the best and the fair shot at things that they really need. So we have to look at each of those barriers and figure out different ways to address them. One of the most important principles in healthcare is do no harm. And that's why before a medicine or a vaccine is approved by the Food and Drug Administration, not only is it tested to see if it works, it's tested in animals to make sure it doesn't do harm, and then it's tested in increasingly larger trials. And so anytime a vaccine is approved, it has gone through this step, and we need to know that these vaccines are safe. But we also need to know that do no harm means when we set up a system to provide vaccines in a non-healthcare setting, like a community institution, that we have the appropriate safety backups so that if something adverse does occur, we're prepared to act on it and act on it quickly. It's so disheartening how much time we spend on fighting against things that there should be no debate about. Vaccines literally save lives. Starting in 1974, the UN set up a program to bring vaccines throughout the world. They have now analyzed that over the past 50 years, more than 150 million children's lives have been saved from this. 40% of childhood deaths that have been prevented or because of vaccines. It's one of the biggest, most important ways that we have to save the lives of children. We don't have polio anymore. We don't have smallpox anymore. Now let's talk about access, because a lot of times in healthcare, we think, oh, we have something good to offer. We're just going to sit there and they'll come. If you build it, they will come. And it's just not true. Access is not a passive process. Access means trying to understand what are the barriers or what's holding people back from coming to you. And then access is how can we address those barriers, whether it's extending the healthcare hours of a health center into the evening or into the weekend, making sure that health centers are close to where people are or close to transportation. There are places in the country, especially rural areas, where it could take hours for someone to get there and be actually quite expensive. So in that case, we have to look at, can we facilitate that? You know, can we do carpools? Can we hire vans to bring people? Or are there elements of the healthcare that we're delivering that we can deliver locally, that we don't have to bring everyone into the healthcare center? A very successful thing from our most recent round of vaccines, especially for COVID, was giving the vaccines through pharmacies. Pharmacies are usually much more accessible and much more localized than health centers are. And pharmacists are licensed to be able to give vaccines. You know, it's funny because with healthcare and with medicine, we're always thinking, how can we be more technological? How can we be more advanced? But sometimes the key to the work we do is what are the basic things that we need to address? And literally, having a place to go that people can get to is crucial. Another part of this is payment. If you have health insurance or you have Medicaid, usually that will pay for most vaccines. But there are many parts of the country where Medicaid was not expanded, where not everybody who should and could get Medicaid actually gets it. So the financial considerations always have to be there. You have to understand, if you're writing someone a prescription, how are they going to pay for it? If you're asking them to come for a vaccine, how are they going to pay for it? Part of our field is public health, and public health is much more used to thinking in these terms of how can we make sure the healthcare that we have can get out to the public. Barriers makes me think about a patient of mine. Let's call him Jose. He was a very dynamic young man in his early 30s. He had two children. He was raising the children on his own because his wife had passed away a few years earlier. Mostly the children are taken care of by his mother. He does speak English, but he's working two jobs because he wants to provide the best for his children. And with the money he makes, he doesn't buy a car, he takes a bus to work. And he wants to get his kids vaccinated, number one, because he believes in vaccines, and number two, in order for them to return to school. And when he starts to put this together, he realizes that the clinic that where his kids are usually seen is only open late on Tuesday night, and late for them is from 4 to 6. His workday ends at 5. How's he gonna get there in time? His mother, who takes care of the kids, is elderly and really can't walk and get the kids to the clinic to get the healthcare that they need. So here's someone who wants to do the right thing, who's working really hard for his kids, but he can't quite figure out how to put it all together. I think there are several approaches that could be taken to really help someone like Jose. The first could be something like a mobile vaccination clinic. They could be set up in a van that drives around, or they could be in a local community organization, but they're literally in the neighborhoods where people live, and it just makes access to vaccinations much, much easier. And we have a great example of this with libraries. They have rolling libraries that drive up to your neighborhood because they know books are important. So bringing services to the people who need them are well established in fields even beyond healthcare. So school-based health centers are health centers that are literally based within the school. And it's not like kids can just show up. They have to have parental permission in order to access those facilities. But it's made a tremendous difference for young people being able to access emergency care, like for asthma during the day if they have trouble breathing, or to even get access to things like vaccines. But having the clinical facility right in the school enables us to get to sick children faster and to provide the kind of preventive care. We even can give medications to kids who need medications during the day through a school-based health center. So schools and teachers are talking a lot about how they have to go beyond just education to becoming social workers, to solving problems in their kids' lives, you know. So we knew we had to develop feeding programs in schools, whether that's breakfast in schools or free lunches in schools. So schools are expanding their missions. And I think school-based health centers are one of the places in which they realize they can really provide a great service to their students and to their communities. As a provider, I think you can contact your local health department and ask them which schools have school-based clinics and are there special rules to get students engaged in those programs. If you can find one contact in the Department of Health that if you have a suggestion, you can go to and you could say, can we try this as a pilot? I've heard this worked. I've heard, I just read an article about this. It sounded so cool. Do you think we could try that as a pilot here in our community? I think we've realized for a long time that not all healthcare needs to be delivered in expensive healthcare facilities like hospitals or clinics. And there's a lot of basic healthcare that can be given through community-based facilities, whether that's local organizations or religious organizations. And one of the really nice things about these kind of organizations is they are usually run by people who are trusted by many people in the community who may have hesitancy, fears, intimidation by the healthcare system itself. There are many people for whom faith leaders are important. They're important communicators. Often they're from the same racial or ethnic groups as the people who need the services. There are community agencies whose leaders have risen to have a lot of respect in the community, whether it's community agencies providing services like housing or social services or diversion from jail or help getting people jobs, or even political leaders who have community service centers. All those people have different folks in the community who respect them, who want to learn from them, who want to get services from them. So I think if we realize that to be effective healthcare providers, we have to partner with people who are viewed as important leaders in the community. We are taught a very technical language, so learning how to translate what we say into understandable English, but also you don't want to have people feel like you're being condescending to them. But I think most people would rather, you know, make sure you understood it, and they'll go, oh yeah, of course I knew that. And you're like, okay, I'm sorry, you know, sometimes people don't. The most important thing for me is that what I'm saying you understand. I can't tell you how many times I listen to, you know, doctors or nurses in training, and they're so afraid of not sounding smart enough that they will use the most complicated ways of saying things. But sophistication, I think we have to rethink and realize that it's about communicating to the person who's right in front of you. That's our job, is to help that person. The other thing related to language is way too often we have a message to give. And so we sort of plug ourselves in and go on autopilot and start saying things. So when I'm trying to convince someone of why they should get a vaccine, I'll start talking about the benefits of it. But that might not at all be what they're looking for from me. They might have a completely different reason. They may have heard that you get autism from childhood vaccines. That's a myth, but no one has taken the time to unpack that myth for them. So for me, language is also listening and understanding what that person's understanding is and addressing their question, not your list of issues you want to communicate. And then finally, what I think, you know, most people think of as language barriers are people who speak different languages. It's expensive, but if you can have somebody on your staff who speaks the first or second or third most common language after English, that's great. But there's also some really great things in technology. You can have what you're saying be translated into another language. The thing to be careful about with translation is that you're still keeping it on a level someone can understand. I find my language familiarity is obviously not that great. English is number one for me. Spanish, I don't do that well. But if I try and say simple sentences, people seem to appreciate it. They appreciate that I've made the effort, and it also helps them feel less insecure about what they may be saying in English. And, you know, and I'll usually say, you know, your English is better than my Spanish. The main message I just want to say is that language is not just different foreign language. Language starts with, you know, understanding, making our medical concepts much simpler, and finding a way to check in that people understand what you're saying and that what you're saying is answering what their questions are. A lot of these things that we've been talking about could be very effective with someone like Jose. finding out with the health department what are some easier access points, finding out if the grandmother has a telephone and calling the grandmother with someone who has the potential to speak Spanish. And so your work is not going to be in the convincing space. Your work is going to be in the practical, physical problem-solving space. You can't cure every disease, but finding a way for someone to get their medicine, to get it administered routinely, to get some services, is really a wonderful and exciting role that you could play as a healthcare provider. Thank you so much for watching this module today. It was a great honor for me to participate in hopefully providing some information to help make vaccines more accessible for children, parents, and families. Vaccines for children are literally life-saving, so everything and anything you can do can really help us advance the health of children.